Swindon propping up the division as they have been all season and still looking for their first away win. The commentator at Ewood Park is Clive Tilsley. You can possibly make out his shadow here. Unfortunately, because of building work and the sunny conditions, there are quite a few shadows, but I hope they won't spoil your enjoyment of the game.
Ewood Park will soon be a stage fit for champions. Three sides of the 30,000 capacity all-seater stadium are now complete. By the time next season begins, this will be the Jack Walker stand, completing his £25 million redevelopment of the ground. For now, it's a makeshift home for two cameramen and one commentator. Kenny Dalglish's multi-million pound team building is ahead of schedule too, with a genuine championship chance now. Mike Newell made a winning return at Hillsborough last weekend and keeps Paul Warhurst's imminent return under wraps. He's on the substitutes bench. Success hasn't come cheap, but Dalglish has spent wisely and bought young. Average age today, just 25. They're making an old man very happy. The team that Jack built could be level pegging with United come next Saturday's summit meeting here. Swindon Town are fighting an altogether different fight. Rooted to the foot of the Premiership despite matching United last Saturday. Kevin Horlock and Frank McAvenny have picked up injuries since then. Paul Bodin and Martin Ling returned to the escape committee, but they're running out of time. Kelvin Morton is the man in charge. Spring is here, the season when the prizes are handed out, and Blackburn Rovers still have their eyes on the star prize. Swindon Town trying to avoid one of the booby prizes. David Batty looking for Mike Newell, policed by Adrian Whitbread. This is Wilcox, and Sean Taylor, the Swindon captain, able to bring it away. Once upon a time, Blackburn's home form looked like being the undoing of their season. Just 6 points from their first six games here. But it's become the making of their season thanks to 10 straight Premiership wins at Ewood Park, where they've built themselves a reputation even quicker than they built their grandstands. Wilcox caught in possession by Nyholt. This is Graham Lasseau. Flicked on by Newell to Shearer. Paul Bowden back in the Swindon side. Straight to Tim Sherwood. Nice dummy by the referee. Swindon have never quite climbed off the bottom rung of the Premiership ladder. They're only 6 points shy of the safety mark, but their goal difference deficit is comfortably the worst, and they played more games than everyone else. And they've got Alan Shearer to deal with this afternoon. And they're going to have to start tunnelling a little bit quicker than the rest if they're going to make that great escape. Here's Nicky Summerby, whose name was linked with Blackburn Rovers in the pre-deadline transfer gossip. And already involved a little row with Graham Lasseau. This is Wilcox. Head out by Kilclyde, but not decisively. Newell. It's a corner. Mike Newell lose the old man of this team at 29 years of age. Wilcox with the corner. In towards David May. Reasonably unguarded there, mate. His header was straight at Fraser Digby. Laurie Sanchez. Summerby. Going to be a key contest, that, with Lasseau. Hendry at full stretch, and it almost found a way through to Sanchez. Blackburn have got a free kick as Sanchez wrestled to try and win possession. But Nicky Summerby, who is a superb crosser of the ball, teased the Blackburn defence with a A cross play just in between defender and goalkeeper. Hendry just got a boot on it. Flowers couldn't claim it, but neither could Sanchez. Fjortoft running free. And Swindon are in front. A sensational start. A goal in 4 minutes for Jan Åge Fjortoft, who is as hot as anybody in the country at the moment. 11 goals in his last 10 matches. And Blackburn have been shocked by the Norwegian World Cup player. Hendry tried to hold him back, but Fjortoft went on and struck it confidently beyond a helpless Flowers. He went 22 games without a goal following his club record move. And now he can't stop scoring. Wilcox to Batty. Some of it's gone all the way back. And got all the way round. And emerged with the ball. Offside against Fjortoft. Free kick taken from inside the Swindon half. Retaken by Lasso. Shearer. Shearer! They say he's been going through a goal drought. Well, it's over. Six whole games without a goal, and Alan Shearer scores an absolute screamer to equalise. As soon as he turned Kilcline, the possibility was there, and it became a probability once he made contact. And Swindon Town were in front for just 3 minutes. It's number 29 of the season for Alan Shearer. He actually had one incorrectly ruled out by a linesman's flag at Hillsborough last week, but no doubting that one. He's back in business. Berg taking a chance against his Norwegian World Cup teammate Fjortoft. Wilcox, Batty, in towards Newell. Digby just got there ahead of him. Newell just had to check his run to make sure he was going to be onside. Shearer's got it back for Ripley. Here's Newell again, and now Wilcox. Shearer trying to make something of it. The free kick has already gone Swindon Town's way. But Swindon were pulled one way and then the other before Jason Wilcox tried to deliver the tunning cross. Mike Newell was central to much of it. And the ball just bounced and bobbled away from him there. And Digby was able to get out to smother. John Gorman bellying out the instructions to the Swindon Town players. There's Whitbread again, Sanchez. Now Sherwood and Batty becoming quite a formidable combination at the heart of matters for Blackburn. Combination was picked there by Swindon's harassing. And here's some of it. It was deflected and it took an awkward bounce. And it might come here for Lynn, and it might still. It's taken another deflection. And eventually off Berg for a corner. Well, Tim Flowers just couldn't quite read the flight of that cross from Somerby when it was diverted off a boot. Fjortoft beat him to it, Ling beat him to it, but Hendry and Berg managed to touch the ball to safety. Ling had the best side of goal. Bowden with a corner. Taylor's there, Kilcline's there. Promise for Swindon, but sadly for their cause, no end product from Brian Kilcline. Sherwood getting to some of it and being penalised. Nyholt, away by Hendry. Sanchez though, here's Fjortoft. May was certainly very close to him. Newell on to Ripley, and now Shearer looking for Ripley, who's onside. Whitbread covering. Ripley's won it from him. Newell is free for a moment. Still Ripley. Eventually Ling got back there. Digby didn't dare pick it up. Berg. Headed by Kilclyde. Lasso. Now Wilcox. Way by Whitbread. Lasso. Wilcox again. In towards Newell this time. Really good cross. Towards Newell. Stiff test for Digby from Wilcox. Shearer. Charged down by Taylor. Back in by Bird. Shearer! Blackburn go in front with a captain's goal from Tim Sherwood. And that early aberration which allowed Jan Fjortoft to give Swindon the lead now seems a distant memory. Henning Berg, who forced the winning goal for Mike Newell at Sheffield Wednesday last weekend, forced this goal for Tim Sherwood, who picked his spot sweetly. And goals in successive home games for Sherwood. Score against Liverpool here 3 weeks ago. Blackburn 2, Swindon 1. Batty looking for Ripley again. Moncur has gone back with him. Bonner. Twelve minutes of the first half remaining. And Blackburn Rovers' supremacy is growing. Wilcox in towards Shearer! It's 3-1. No! It's been disallowed. Alan Shearer's had another one wiped off, and he's looking in the direction of the linesman on the near side. Presumably, he spotted some pushing. Not that time. Given away by Moncur to Batty. Here's Wilcox. It's hung up for Newell. Seemed to get a little nudge there from Bowden. Back in by Ripley. Batty! Saved by Digby. Shearer! You wouldn't have been able to get a bet against him missing that. Well, by his very high standards, that's an astonishing miss. Super strike by David Batty. And Shearer against Digby, no contest. If he'd hit the target, most unlike him. And David Batty, who never seems to score, denied by a super save. Here's Bowden. Somerby. Deflected. Oof, just wide. There was a loud appeal there against Fjortoft for offside, but some of it didn't listen to that or look for a flag. He tried to make the most of the opening, but Graham Lasso made a difficult obstacle for him to pass and eventually managed to get a foot on the ball. Bowden will take the corner kick. Not a good one, doesn't even clear Newell. Moncur. Sanchez. Kilclyde is there. It's come off May. It's come for Whitbread. Charged down well by Hendry. Blackburn have had one or two flutters now. Swindon were a little unfortunate there. Ripley. Newell has Wilcox outside of him. Shearer was waiting beyond the far post. Ripley was coming into the near post. Blackburn have a free kick. Somerby on Wilcox. That was clever. That wasn't so clever. Patter cake set up. But it's Tim Sherwood's goal which separates the two sides at half time. A game which set off like Linford Christie with two in the opening 7 minutes. Jan Fjortoft for Swindon, Alan Shearer at last for Blackburn. But Sherwood's goal after 28 minutes is the difference, and Blackburn have deserved the lead. 2-1. No such thing as a day off for the workmen who are changing the face of Ewood Park, but their handiwork is casting some strange shadows on the playing surface. It's anybody's guess what the survival total will be. 49 points wasn't enough to save Crystal Palace last year, and 49 is now maximum points for Swindon. That's if they win today. Here's Sean Taylor. As for the top, the championship runners-up have never got more than 86 points. And if Blackburn win their home games and draw their away games, they'll have 87. Here's Fjortoft. And Flowers got to that one. And Jan Fjortoft almost started the second half with the same kind of bang with which he triggered the first. Touch forward to him. And a well-struck volley, and long way down for Flowers. Good save. Heading Bird. Alan Shearer. Lovely turn. He's got his corner. Wilcox. Header away by Taylor. Ripley. Batty. Wilcox. Ripley. Headed by Kilcline. Hendry. Struck Taylor. Shearer. Good save. Newell. Hit him in the face. Deserved his luck though. Taylor got it away. Brave keeping by Fraser Digby. Wilcox. Caught hold of that Wilcox, but always rising. But Fraser Digby, who may just have a little vested interest in the outcome of the championship race. He was an apprentice with Manchester United once upon a time. And it was a remarkable save that he made. A good one from Shearer, but then the one from Newell, I think, went straight past his hands and actually hit him on the shoulder, not the face. Here's Newell. Ripley. We've got two balls on the field at the moment. There's Ripley. I think he's got the right one. Behind Sherwood. Blocked by Kilcline. Still Sherwood. Deflected. Didn't miss by much. The diversion was just to Swindon Town's benefit. Once Blackburn had taken the new ball, they nearly got another scalp. Just missing off stump. By a remarkable coincidence, today's two managers made their playing debuts in the same game. John Gorman's one and only appearance in the Celtic first team was in a League Cup tie at Hamilton in 1968, and the Celtic sub that day was a 17-year-old debutant called Kenny Dalglish. Fjortoft. Here's Nyholt. Still Nyholt. It was deflected for a corner. That deflected goal that he scored against Manchester United last weekend was his first in English football. David May got the block on that effort from Nyholt. Towards Taylor, won by Hendry, then by Sherwood. Summerby. Bowden. Kilcline. Sanchez. Hendry managed to squeeze it away. Fjortoft! And Swindon Town have looked every bit as likely to score as Blackburn since the break. Jan Fjortoft again providing the cutting edge. It's a good effort, really. They try to hook it from behind him. Strong play by Sherwood. Newell running free to his left, Ripley to his right. Ripley's cross. Hillcline's header. Ripley again, took a stumble. Penalty. Myholt found guilty after a long, hard look by Calvin Morton. Stuart Ripley's initial cross was cleared back to him. Well, Myholt didn't get the ball, he got Ripley. Jury out at the moment on the outcome of this game. A successful penalty would surely finish it in Blackburn's favour. Currently two penalties amongst Alan Shearer's 29 goals this season. Oh, and Digby got to it but couldn't keep it out. Shearer makes it 3-1 and keeps the heat on Manchester United. It's his 27th league goal of the season. He's just two behind Andy Cole in the race to 30. Nobody scored 30 in the top division since 87. Cole's got a day off today and Shearer adds to his tally, much to the frustration of Fraser Digby. 30 up in total for Alan Shearer. Ripley looking for the pace of Warhurst. Sherwood, on towards Shearer. Hat-trick chance for Alan Shearer. Good save by Fraser Digby. Stood up for as long as he could and made an excellent stop to deny Shearer his first ever hat-trick at Ewood Park. Sherwood. Well, over and over again you hear football pundits advising goalkeepers to stay on their feet for as long as they can. And that's just what Digby did. He made Shearer make his move. Another small step for Blackburn as they try to take a giant leap over Manchester United in the coming weeks. Two goals for Alan Shearer, taking his league and cup total for the season to 30 in a 3-1 win. That's 12 straight league wins at Ewood Park, where Manchester United are next in line next Saturday. And who knows who will be leading the way come next week's match of the day. Blackburn must tackle the ace gatecrashers Wimbledon on Tuesday night before they turn their minds to United. One thing is certain about any Kenny Dalglish team, they'll take every game as it comes. They've won this one by 3-1.
Kenny, what was your assessment of today's game?
We struggled a little bit at the beginning, then picked ourselves up. Alan scored a great goal. For the remainder of the first half, I thought we were totally in command. We could have scored a lot more than the two goals we came in with at half-time. The start of the second half, Tim's had a good save. And the boy got the chance when it was 3-1. But overall, we were delighted. I don't think the 3-1 scoreline would suggest that it's been a totally convincing result. But I think that's misleading. I think if you look at the facts and the shots at goal and the possession we had and the opportunities we got ourselves, I think you find that 3-1 was in no way at all flattering to us. And I think it may be a little bit unkind to us as well.
How do you compare them to Manchester United, having seen the two in the space of a week?
I think Blackburn are a harder working side, to be fair. I think United have perhaps got more flair and ability in their team, but Blackburn, man for man, are a harder working team.
Which is going to be the more successful, do you think?
I think it will be deciding the game between the two of them in a week's time, I think it is, isn't it?
What about Swindon's fate? Is that inevitable or not?
No, we've got an uphill struggle, but we've still got 7 games left. I mean, 7 wins and we're safe.
I mean, you know all about good spirit at a club from Wimbledon. It is quite extraordinary how high the spirit is here.
Yeah, I've been surprised myself. I've come in. I mean, there's loads of ability throughout this team. Hopefully a little bit of the Wimbledon spirit can be ingested into them and then we can take it from there. But the boys are still buzzing.
But you've seen both teams, you've played against both teams in the space of a week. How do you rate them against each other?
It's hard to say. I mean, we played against United when they were in a bad shape and they get a sending off and all that. I think we should have won against United. Blackburn today more deserved to win than United did. And I think seeing the two performance of the two teams, Blackburn Rovers is at the moment the best team.
But at the top, there are now just 3 points in it. And, of course, Blackburn, as has been said, can draw level on points, that is, anyway, if they win away to Wimbledon on Tuesday night. It's mighty close, Trevor.
Well, and a great credit to Blackburn to get that close. Today, as Kenny said, it could have been, well, about 8-3, I think, on chances. You know, it was end-to-end stuff. And they've entertained us again, haven't they? Swindon all season. I mean, I think they're going to go down. But you have to say, you know, we've had some great
days. They played a full part in making it an entertaining game.
That's right.
But as you say, Blackburn did miss some chances there.
Well, Swindon have conceded 85 goals, I think, which is 30 more than any other side. And you can see in this match, I mean, I thought Alan Shearer was a bit unlucky on... You know, they said that he nudged Adrian Whitbread in the back. But I think he gets up very early and hangs there and diverts it into the top corner. And as I say, he looked pretty frustrated when it was disallowed. But it's good to see him back on song. I mean, it was a brilliant equaliser, wasn't it, so soon after Swindon went ahead. But he probably is sitting at home now wondering how on earth he missed this particular chance. David Batty, unlucky. And, I mean, it was a defensive clearance, wasn't it?
Digby played pretty well, though, didn't he?
Digby was excellent. I mean, here again, Alan Shearer looking for a hat-trick when he got his penalty. And again, Mike Newell hits him on the chest. Digby up twice very, very quickly. And then the last opportunity. Good to see Paul Warhurst here just in the ball down, just came on for a late run. And Sherwood releases Shearer. And you think, well, this is going to be the third one, collect that match ball. But he did stand up well, Digby. And again, 3-1. But he's having plenty of practice, that's the problem.
Sure. Another word from you in a moment about the run into the championship. They've got 9 games left apiece. Fjortoft, though, for Swindon, played well today. They've got some nice players in the team,
well,
despite
their
predicament.
He was nearly on his way home, wasn't he, just after Christmas? And then I think it's about 10 goals now in the last 9 league matches. The first one was strange, because Colin Hendry looks as if he's appealing for a free kick here. But, you know, it's fatal, isn't it, to turn around and wait. And Jan Fjortoft says, well, just to make sure I put it in the net and then we'll argue about it afterwards. And he's finishing, you know, he's been excellent in the air in recent weeks. But again, his good movement here, you know, just picks it up there off the shoulder and spreads the play. I mean, he's predominantly right-footed. His left one doesn't feature very often. But it's good to see him linking up play so well. And, of course, earlier at the start of the second half, this looked like an equaliser. It was an excellent volley yet again. And Tim Flowers stretched superbly to tip around that post. And, of course, 2-2 at that stage, who knows? And again, you know, late on, headed on, Sanchez, Kilcline dives in and swivels for a tall man, very sharp, and just missed the far post. And I think it'd be very interesting to see how he shapes up for Norway in the World Cup, of course.
But he's one man who's off to the World Cup, luckily. But the run-in now, you've been having a look at the matches left. Let's take Blackburn first. How do you see it?
Well, I think the next three are critical, aren't they? Wimbledon on Tuesday.
No losses?
Well, I mean, it's probably unrealistic. You think they're going to have a stumble somewhere. But, I mean, they've won 13 out of 16, only losing at Arsenal. And, you know, that a point at Wimbledon, then Manchester United next Saturday. I've gone sitting on the fence there with a point apiece. Everton, Easter Monday away. I think they'll win there, but, of course, Everton are desperate for points. And then that last half a dozen, you know, if you're looking for a run-in, doesn't look bad. So it depends, I think, in the next 10 days, how they come through that top three as to where they go from there.
Villa at home might be tricky, actually.
Yes, I mean, they're so unpredictable, Villa, aren't they? But they have been better away from home, you're quite right.
91 points is an awful lot.
Well, it's more than anyone's won the championship in the past. I mean, Manchester United won it last year on 84 points, and here we are talking about poor old Blackburn perhaps getting to 91, you know, even if they get in the high 80s and not even winning the championship.
All right, let's look at United then and see what you've made of their run-in.
Well, again, Liverpool, it can always be a difficult team for them, but they're at home, so I've gone for the win. I've gone for the draw then, Blackburn. Oldham, you know, the meeting of the FA Cup semi-final, they're looking for points, but again, the home form. I think the dodgy two are the Leeds and Wimbledon. I've gone for them drawing and winning, but they're both difficult games. Leeds, you know, stumbled today because they met, but I think, you know, they are both games away from home, which could prove troublesome, although after that, I've gone for that last four against, you know, Man City, Southampton needing points, but I've gone for them if they've reached that sort of stage unscathed. I think they could.
Blackburn Rovers have won their last 10 home games in the Premier League, and if, as the form book dictates, they beat Swindon here, they'll cut Manchester United's lead at the top to just 3 points. It once stood at 16 points. And remember, United come here next Saturday in a game of enormous significance which could decide the championship itself. That's Mike Newell, and Wilcox getting in the early cross. This is the Swindon skipper, Sean Taylor. Swindon Town, who haven't won away all season, but remember, they did hold Manchester United at the County Ground last week, and if nothing else, the spirit is still alive. They are 6 points away from the safety zone, and hope springs eternal. This is Somervey getting past Lasso. He's an excellent crosser, usually Somervey. That's a testing one. It nearly fell for Sanchez on the far post. And Blackburn in some early trouble there, though. The flag is up on the far side. Well, he's one of Swindon Town's most potent weapons, Nicky Somervey, with his runs down the right-hand side and crosses. And this one eluded everybody, and I thought Sanchez was going to attack it and score on the far post. Sanchez heading it forward again, and Fjortoft here, and into the net for Swindon Town. I was looking for the flag, it hasn't come, and Fjortoft has given Swindon a shock lead here. Well, he just cannot stop scoring. Jan Arge Fjortoft, Blackburn Rovers, caught out right at the start. 11 goals in 10 games for Jan Arge Fjortoft. Blackburn were looking for the offside, it never arrived. Fjortoft said thanks. Well, Swindon Town will hope that the goals of Jan Arge Fjortoft can help them to get out of the hole they've been in all season. But here's Shearer looking for the equaliser and producing it. How about that? Brilliant goal from Alan Shearer. And already it's 1-1. 6 games without a goal. The law of averages dictated that he was due one, and when it arrived, wasn't that a superb strike? It's his 29th of the season. And Digby didn't smell it.
Give me a runner, work!
It's Batty and Newell in there. Digby wins it with his feet. And Kirkline was composed enough, he almost took too much time. Back here to Ripley. Newell. Wilcox wide. And that will be behind. It was out of play. And Swindon Town there, just a wee bit charitable, giving the ball away right on the edge of their own penalty area and almost being made to pay. This is Ling. Somervey and Flowers has to judge this correctly. He's made a bit of a hash of it. It's Ling with a great chance, and Blackburn Rovers get away with it. Berg puts it for the corner, but Tim Flowers there looked anything but the world's costliest goalkeeper. It was an awkward bounce, to be fair to him. He was waiting, and Ling had the chance, and Blackburn were a bit lucky to get away with that. Ripley here now, taking on Bowden. Blackburn having the throw. Shearer. Taylor was in the way. Back in again, and Sherwood has scored. Tim Sherwood with number two for Blackburn Rovers. And that was very, very deftly done by the Blackburn Rovers skipper. It's his third goal of the season. And he just tucked this away almost nonchalantly. Shearer it was who cut it back off Taylor, back in again by Berg, and cool as you like from the skipper. Yule tries to reach it out to Ripley, back in again, and the goal for Berg is in. Shearer, somehow, how did he miss that? Digby can't believe it, and I don't think Shearer can either. That was absolutely extraordinary. Well, here's Ripley. It was Batty's effort, in fact, and then Shearer somehow screwed it wide. Moncur, oh, goodness me, this is Wilcox's terrible error. Will they be made to pay? No, Digby's feet, and probably his toes it was, that just stopped that going in. But once again, Swindon there were the architects of their own problems. Moncur gave this to Wilcox, and the goalkeeper just bailed them out. Here's Fjortoft on the volley, and Tim Flowers did well to keep that out. It was another tricky one from Swindon's currently ace goalscorer. I have to say, Blackburn looked fast asleep again at the start of the half. Nyholt plays it forward to Fjortoft. No challenge. And well saved by Flowers. Batty. Wilcox back to Ripley. Kilcline gets it away. Hendry had the effort, and a great save there. But it may go in from Newell. Two tremendous saves from Fraser Digby to keep Swindon Town just about in business here. Wilcox, terrific run. And just over the top. And things happening so fast in that Swindon Town penalty area. Well, Fraser Digby there performs some heroics. Hendry getting it back in again. First of all, it was Shearer. Fingertip save. Newell really fancied his chances, but the goalkeeper denied him too. Shearer. Wilcox out on the left. Looking a very good player on his right foot. And that one goes arrowing across goal, wanting a touch. But this Jason Wilcox is now looking a very, very hot property indeed. Usually very left-footed, this time onto the right foot, and quite a way wide in the end. Now Bowden. One by Phil Klein, back in by Sanchez, and Fjortoft with a clever effort on the turn. Well, he really has played well in opponents' penalty areas in recent weeks, Jan Arge Fjortoft. After no goals in 21 games for Swindon, he's now produced 11 in 10, including the one today, and this was nearly another one. Here's Sherwood. Wilcox and Shearer were ahead of him. Instead, he chooses Ripley on the right. Kilcline gets it away, and Ripley going down. Was it inside the area? Is this going to be a penalty kick? It is. Swindon are not happy at all about this. Let's have a look at this again. Ripley gets the crossing. It's headed away. And back goes Ripley again. Under Nyholt's challenge. Now, this might tell you more. Well, I think Ripley just fell over his legs. Right, is it number 30 for the season for Shearer? Now he's taking his time. Here he goes. And just about. Fraser Digby got his hands to that. And Alan Shearer got his second goal of the game. And that looks to be that for Blackburn Rovers. Yes, he did get a hand to it and was unlucky not to keep it out. Blackburn Rovers are making a substitution meanwhile. Mike Newell is coming off, and Paul Warhurst is reintroduced to get a little run out. He broke his leg in the corresponding fixture at Swindon Town, And he's back as substitute to a big welcome from the Blackburn fans. And here is Shearer away again. He's looking for the hat-trick this time, and Digby denies him. Well, the goalkeeper has made any number of important saves to keep it down to three. Sherwood flips it in again, but nothing doing there. Inside the last minute, well, here was Shearer, and you probably would have put money on him for the hat-trick, but no. And the final whistle goes to give Blackburn Rovers their 11th successive home win, and more significantly, to cut Manchester United's lead at the top of the Premier League to only 3 points. Alan Shearer, who'd gone 6 games without a goal, including his England appearance, comes back with 2, including that disputed penalty late on, which settled all of Blackburn Rovers' anxiety while there was only the one goal cushion. Swindon Town, well, more naive defending from them. They were indebted to their goalkeeper, Fraser Digby, for some heroics to keep the score down. But Jan Fjortoft, at least he came up with a goal, and one to shock Blackburn too after 4 minutes. But Alan Shearer with his 2 goals, another from Tim Sherwood, Blackburn had the last word in the end, and their terrific run continues. It's now 32 points out of 35, and Manchester United come to this very ground in what looks like now a title showdown next Saturday. Here, Blackburn Rovers 3, Swindon Town 1.
Struggled a little bit at the beginning, then picked myself up. Alan scored a great goal. For the remainder of the first half, I thought we were totally in command. We could have scored a lot more than the 2 goals that came in at half time. The start of the second half, Tim's had a good save. And the boy scored a chance when it was 3-1. But overall, we were delighted. I don't think the 3-1 scoreline would suggest that it's been a totally convincing result. But I think that's misleading. I think if you look at the facts and the shots at goal and the possession we had and the opportunities we got ourselves, I think you find that 3-1 was in no way at all flattering to us. And I think it may be a little bit unkind to us as well.
I don't say they were much better than us today. What I say, they had a lot more chances than us. But we again did a great match, I think. We play away against Blackburn Rovers. They could be the league champion. And in 2 games now, we couldn't see how much difference between top and the bottom.
It's going to be interesting. Man United are red-hot favourites. They're in the driving seat. They've proved they're the best team in the Premiership up to now. But the season doesn't end now. There's a long way to go. We'll give it our best shot. That's all we can do.
And this is what the papers make of it this morning. On the back pages, the Mail on Sunday simply says, Sparkling Shearer keeps heat on United. The Observer headline is Rovers trumps impatience game. Michael Walker points out that Swindon Town did Man United no favours last Saturday, but they were the second best against Rovers, who recorded their 11th consecutive home league win. The Telegraph headline is Final Countdown for Blackburn. Blackburn's theme music is now pretty appropriate to background music for Tuesday's match with Wimbledon, which could bring them level with United. One man who knows all about that, of course, Dean Holdsworth. It does seem extraordinary, doesn't it, that Man United seem to be running away with it, and then suddenly there's only 3 points in it.
Yeah, that's right. They've been... it's been a bit of a lull in the season, and they've let themselves down a little bit. When Blackburn have capitalised on that and kept doing their job, kept getting the 3 points, and they're only 3 points behind, and they've got to play them still.
They do seem to be on a roll, Blackburn, at the moment. Do you reckon you can stop them on Tuesday?
We're going to give it our best shot to stop them on Tuesday. And, you know, they'll come down. We owed them one for beating us up at Ewood Park when they put on a great display. And I'm sure we'll try and ruffle their feathers on Tuesday.
Well, let's take a look at some of the chances yesterday, because there were a lot of chances, and really there could have been a lot more goals.
That's right. Their movement off the ball is brilliant, and you know they do create. They get the ball in the box. There's Mike Newell trying to get on the end of a ball into the box there, and as you see, Fraser Digby's was a bit of a thorn in their side yesterday. Although they did score 3 goals, he's kept a heavily bombardment of goals going in.
Yeah, he did manage to keep the score down. He had a terrific game, actually, Digby, didn't he?
Oh, he played out of this world. And
how Shearer missed that?
I think he'd be kicking himself today, Alan. But you can see he's a smile on his face, and he knows he's made an error there. But he gets himself up again, and, you know, he's after scoring one great goal, he's still got the confidence, which is a mark of a great goal scorer, to put a penalty away later on in the game. This is the movement off the ball. He's, again, brilliant, and Wilcox, Shearer, Ripley, have all had chances in the game. And as I say, it could have been quite a heavy defeat for Swindon.
There's another chance went begging there. It was perhaps unfortunate for Swindon because they had a much better game than the scoreline suggests, didn't they?
Yeah, it suggests that, you know, the 3-1, they've got beat quite easily. It could have been easier, but as I say, with Digby playing in that sort of form, and if Swindon had taken their chances, you know, it could have been maybe a point for Swindon. And, you know, 2 points lost for Blackburn, sorry.
Yeah. Three Blackburn players here had a go, and Digby somehow managed to save them all.
It's one of them days when, you know, the goalkeeper's in the right position for nearly all the game. I think any other day he would have had a clean sheet. But once they keep shooting and shooting at you, I think, you know, the law of averages say that the ball's going to end up in the back of the net.
Now, I think we're going to take a look at some of the goals. And there was a somewhat controversial penalty that led to Shearer scoring. I mean, this is, first of all, we'll take a look at Shearer's first goal. Oh, not yet, actually. That was yet another miss. There seem to be so many chances.
And I'd say he's got put through clean here. And I thought he was going to go round him, but he shot early and Digby stood up very well. And
this is the move that finally led to a goal.
This is Alan Shearer at his best. He gets the ball in his feet. It's stuck to his foot. He knows where the goal is, doesn't even look, and smashes the ball. And it's a great goal. So he didn't even have to look. Didn't have to look where the goal was. He knows where it is.
This was the incident that led to the penalty. Yeah. Somewhat controversial.
Nighthawk, got to think he's a little bit unlucky there. But as I say, Ripley's reacted quicker than anyone else there. The ball's come back out. It's two Swindon players. And say Ripley's reacted quicker than anyone else. And it's got him the penalty in the end, you know, at the end of it.
And there was, in fact, Digby very nearly saved that as well, didn't he?
That's right, he was very unlucky. He's gone the right way. And so sure, it's gone, when your luck's that way, it's going in the net for you. Yeah.
But when Swindon scored early on, I mean, I think it was only 4 minutes into the game when Fjortoft scored.
Right.
And that was something like his 11th goal in 9 games.
Yeah, he's hit a real rich vein of form. And I'm sure that Swindon hoping he's going to carry on that and likewise keep clean sheets at the other end of their field.
It's perhaps a bit too late for Swindon, though, isn't
possibly,
it?
But they've got to still keep that spirit. My old friend Laurie Sanchez is in there, and he'll be trying to inject that spirit into the side, so it's not over yet until it's over. And I say they've got to dig in and keep scoring goals and try and keep clean sheets.